This video is sponsored by Roborock. Imagine a world without ice cream, refrigerators, or air conditioning. I know, it's almost too frightening to even think about, but none of those things would be possible without this, the unsung hero that is the heat pump. But heat pumps have always been more expensive than their competition, at least for heating. Well, that might all change with a next generation heat pump technology that ditches the compressors and refrigerants in favor of sound. Yeah, this is the thermoacoustic heat pump, and it might be coming to a home near you sooner than you think. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. Heat pumps are something you probably spend zero time thinking about, but a lot of our modern world wouldn't be possible without them. Just take a look at the population growth of Phoenix, Arizona, and Los Angeles, California. In 1931, engineers H.H. Schultz and J.Q. Sherman developed the first window unit air conditioner. A year later, you could buy one for between $10,000 and $50,000, meaning it was out of reach for nearly everyone. But by 1950, prices came down to a point where they were much more common. Los Angeles had a population of about 4 million in 1950, while Phoenix was only 221,000. It's basically impossible to imagine this kind of growth in desert cities like Phoenix, Arizona, without the rise of air conditioning. And for fun, here are the same numbers for Las Vegas. The real magic of the heat pump is twofold. First, they're really efficient. While an electric or natural gas heater might be upwards of 95% efficient, meaning 1 watt of energy used will produce roughly 1 watt of heat, heat pumps are on another level. Because they don't actually create heat, but pump heat from one location to another, they have a coefficient of performance of between 3 and 5, meaning 1 watt of energy used can produce between 3 or 5 watts of heat. This also allows them to cool spaces by pumping heat energy to the outside, leaving the conditioned space cooler, whether it's your living room or a refrigerator. And there's no other device that can really do this. For a more in-depth explanation of how they work, check out the link in the description for a video we did on heat pumps last year. But for all their greatness, they do have some problems. First, they're expensive and require specialized equipment and HVAC technicians to charge up working fluids or refrigerants that get pumped in the lines. There are some cool products like Mr. Cool that comes with pre-charged line sets to make it easier for us DIYers, which I'll cover in a future video on my home series. Secondly, this working fluid is usually not great for the environment. And when HVAC people tell you that your system needs a tune-up, recharging any refrigerant that escaped is one of those tasks. Now, newer refrigerants are much less harmful compared to older varieties that contain CFCs or chlorofluorocarbons that were tearing a hole in our ozone layer back in the 90s. Plus, heat pumps and ACs have gotten so good and so prolific that they now account for about 10% of all electricity used worldwide. And according to the IEA, that number is expected to triple by 2050. So there's good reason for future research and development. This is the really cool part of the innovation cycle. First, some brilliant people come up with a brilliant idea that might be expensive and out of reach for the average person. But slowly over time, the technology just becomes ubiquitous, like robot vacuum cleaners, which are increasing in popularity at a staggering rate. Like our sponsor this week, Roborock, and this, the S7 Max V Ultra. I've had my Roborock S7 Plus cleaning my house every day for the past year, and it's been flawless. But the S7 Max V Ultra is an unbelievable upgrade, and here's why. It has twice the suction power at 5,100 pascals, rivaling even corded vacuums. It has LiDAR and maps your entire house room by room, and with the smartphone app, you can clean everything or just select rooms. But now it has cameras, and with its reactive AI 2.0 software, it can find obstacles on the floor and avoid them. This is huge because my kids leave toys and things that would get most robot vacuums tangled up and jammed. It also has a dock that empties the dustbin, which other vacs have, but this also has a clean and dirty water bin. So the robot loads up on clean water and mops simultaneously as it vacuums. With Vibrarize, it vibrates the mopping head at 3,000 cycles per minute and automatically lifts the mop when it detects carpet and rugs. Then when it gets dirty, it goes back to the dock where it gets cleaned and the dirty water is sucked up back into the dirty water bin. This is seriously mind-blowing, and I've never seen anything like this. This is the absolute pinnacle of robot floor cleaners. You can even program it to charge during off-peak hours, like at midnight, to save you money. So go check it out yourself today. And between December 14th and 18th, there's a buy one, get one free deal for the S7 Max V Ultra. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Roborock and you for supporting the show. And that brings us to this, a pretty remarkable next generation heat pump that is powered by sound. or more specifically, a thermoacoustic heat pump. And as the name implies, a heat pump that pumps heat using sound waves. Sound waves are just another form of energy, and thermoacoustics is the interaction between sound waves and heat. By the way, while researching this video, I came across the most amazing video by NightHawkInLight on his YouTube channel, where he does some amazing experiments showing these principles in action. So definitely go check that out after this video. At a high level, here is how an acoustic heat pump system works. If you put a speaker like a big subwoofer inside a cylindrical cavity, you can produce sound waves that will bounce off the end of the cylinder and back. But for this to perform meaningful work, we have to match the length of the tube with the frequency of the sound wave. At most frequencies, the sound waves will reflect and interfere and bounce and collide with each other. But reach the natural frequency or resonant frequency of the tube, and you'll have a standing wave that stays in sync. This is the first critical point, and it is a function of sound frequency and the geometry of the cavity. Inside the cavity is a gas, usually helium, because of its really good heat transfer properties. With no sound input, the gas spreads out evenly, and the heat energy is evenly distributed. An incoming sound wave travels through the cavity and increases the pressure at the end where it bounces back. Think of it like a bouncing ball that compresses as it hits the floor before re-energizing and bouncing back. So there is a greater concentration of gas particles, and therefore heat, in this region, and in the middle of the tube, lower pressure and therefore less energy. But turn the sound off and the air just spreads out evenly once again. The key is that the acoustic heat pump needs to capture the heat at this compressed high temperature region in order to develop a thermal gradient to move heat around. Interestingly, there's also a high pressure region at the speaker source on the other end for the same reasons, the reflection of the sound waves. Next, to capture this heat, we need some sort of a heat collector or heat exchanger or a stack, a series of thin sheets that can absorb the heat in the gas without blocking the traveling sound wave too much. Usually in all my videos for capturing heat, we always look for the best possible thermal conductor, things like copper, but that's not actually what we want here. The goal is to build a temperature gradient in the stack, but if we use a great conductor like copper, heat on the hot side would quickly fly and spread back to the cold side faster than the acoustic heat pump could create that gradient. Instead, we want something that's a bit more of an insulator, something that does absorb heat, otherwise this wouldn't work of course, but not so fast that the heat pump can't produce a temperature difference from hot to cold. Various companies will spend a lot of money coming up with this perfect material that strikes the right balance, but it can just be as simple as a stack of plastic. So with a thermal stack on both ends of the pipe, we can essentially double the working output. Next, we need a way to get the heat or cool out of the system, and that can be done with some heat pipes attached to the cold and hot sides. Some system designs combine the stack on each end by attaching the hot side of one stack to the cold side of the other. This cools off the hot side, allowing for even more heat to travel from the cool side to the hot side, resulting in a very cold stack. And on the other side, a very hot stack. So that instead of a hot and cold on two different places, you just have one hot side and one cold side. From here, strong thermal conductors like copper can be attached to the stacks to transfer the heat out of the system where they can heat or cool depending on the use case. Again, the beauty of this system is there's no working fluid, no compressors, and the only moving part is the speaker. And with a good speaker diaphragm material, such a system could easily last over 20 years with zero maintenance. In fact, Equiem, a French company developing a residential acoustic heat pump, says their system can last over 30 years with zero maintenance. They also claim a carbon reduction of 80% compared to traditional gas boilers and a seasonal coefficient of performance higher than a traditional high temperature heat pump. But there are some interesting challenges that acoustic heat pumps introduce. A traditional heat pump works via the changing phase of from liquid to gas of the refrigerant. This temperature where refrigerant boils and condenses helps define the operating temperature range. But in the case of a thermoacoustic system, it's really more about the difference in temperature between the two stacks. Plus, the hotter the hot side becomes, the more likely it will just transfer the heat back to the cold side via convection, or the heat transfer through the gas. So for this to work, engineers and scientists will have to master the perfect material that produces the biggest temperature difference, find clever ways to insulate the tube and even the two stacks, and figure out how the biggest temperature difference could be achieved. While traditional heat pumps have been around for decades and their designs are largely established, this is where different companies will have different approaches to maximize efficiency based on different properties. So the acoustic heat pump, in a lot of ways, is like the Wild West again, where you know, conventional designs that have been around for so long have just kind of been perfected. We're back to square one, and you're going to see a lot of variations and different approaches that different companies take. Clearly, like 30 years from now, the best technology will emerge. But right now, it's kind of anyone's guessing game. And if you're thinking, what about noise levels? Are acoustic heat pumps louder when they're running? I was thinking about this too, but because these cavities are sealed and sound isolated, and there are no large compressors to run, acoustic heat pumps are actually quieter than traditional heat pumps. Another challenge for the acoustic heat pump is the worldwide shortage of helium. Helium is a pretty common gas, but not here on Earth. It's so lightweight that it just escapes out of our atmosphere. And there's been shortages of helium, which some of you guys have pointed out in our video on the Japanese hydrogen nuclear reactors. And that is going to be a problem. So if you need helium now, and yes, it is sealed, so there's really no risk of it leaking over the life of a system, but you still have to get enough helium for all these different heat pumps to work. And there might be some other gases, argon has come up, and there might be some others that could work, but you need something that can really transfer heat well. So that is another limitation. I think acoustic heat pumps will make their way into our lives in the coming years, but I'm not exactly sure of the limitations in terms of operating range. And honestly, most claims are just that, claims, picked to illustrate where these products work best. Can it cool your house when it's 50 degrees Celsius outside? How much would the performance be degraded? And would the coefficient of performance even be higher than one? Because in the case of heating, if it wasn't, you'd be better off running a resistive electric heater. Yes, the benefits could be huge, and I do believe that they will lower operating costs and find plenty of use cases, but I'm going to hold off judgment until I see the first commercial products are available. And when they are, you can bet I'll try to get one and put it through my usual testing. Maybe acoustic heat pumps finally usher in an age where homes are super smart about how they use heat. Maybe excess heat from the refrigerator is moved into your water heater. And if costs were competitive, this sort of heat management could carry out throughout your entire home of tomorrow. As a mechanical engineer, that's pretty exciting. But let's not get ahead of ourselves just yet. What do you think? There's no arguing that thermoacoustic heat pumps are wildly fascinating, but do you see a huge market and bright future for the technology? Or might it never really reach that commercial stage of viability? Or something in between? Sound off in the comments below. All right, that is a look at the thermoacoustic heat pump. Really cool stuff. I mean, sound waves to pump heat around. It's amazing stuff. What a world we live in, right? All right, so check out this video next. I think you'll also like, if you like this one. Happy holidays. It's December, depending on when you watch this. I'm Ricky. This is Tupi Da Vinci. We'll catch you guys next week.